Imam, tell us a bit about the area and how it was at the time and how you came to acquire this building for the masjid.
In December of 1981, I was driving around and I saw this place was available. It was property owned by the city. And there was going to be an auction in 81. We attended the auction and bought this property from the city at the, by the way, which is interesting, at the minimum upset price, which was, I think, I can't remember whether it was $25,000 or $30,000. And, you know, builders were going for $500,000, $600,000, $1 million. And we thought nowhere in the world that we were going to get this for the very minimum upset price. And the reason that we thought that was the case is because this was one of the worst areas in the city in terms of crime. We had the captain of the 79th precinct, which is this area, said that at that time that this was the worst, one of the worst precincts in the city in terms of drugs, death, shootings, robberies, and things like that. So Allah blessed us when we got it in 1981 to begin to clean up the area.
Imam, if you could just tell us a bit about what the area was like when you established the masjid in this area and how the Muslims were able to kind of reform and make this a better area for the whole community.
Let me give you an idea of what it was like. If you look at it now, it's very difficult to imagine what it was. This area was an area of light. I mean, darkness, literally dark. We had 15 crack houses on this block alone. And we decided, and I think with 1987 or 88, to have an anti-drug campaign in this area to get rid of those drug houses. So we had an alliance with the police department. We said that let's have a big rally, anti-drug rally, thousands of people on such and such a date. We did it. And I said, on that date, we want you to raid each one of these 15 drug houses and get the drug dealers out. And we said to them that if you get them out, we'll keep them out. And that's what happened. We had a 40-day anti, 40 days, 40 nights anti-drug campaign where literally we, the Muslim men, stood in front of the drug houses and told the drug dealers and drug buyers, no more drugs can be sold here.
But Imam, just to make a point here, that's not something which is easy to do, and it's quite dangerous.
That is very dangerous to do. But the brothers, with the courage, the faith in Allah, the Almighty, and working together, and the knowledge about drug dealers, and this is the drug dealers, they're business people, you know, and they don't want attention drawn to them. So what they thought, they calculated that, oh, they'll be there for a couple of days, and then we go back, it's business as usual. So what happened, there was a lot of publicity, media was there watching. So that kind of discouraged the drug dealers from being there, and also the strength of the Muslims.
You know, let me just ask you another question. It was bad for their business, but do you find among the criminal element that they just have a level of respect for Muslims which they don't have for other people?
I think at that time, definitely they had a level of respect for Muslims that they don't have other people. However, I'm just going to be honest with you, that over the years, we find some criminal elements that are so wicked. They have respect for no one. They don't have respect for law enforcement with guns. They don't have respect for the church. They don't have respect for the synagogue. Muslims, no masjids, or anything. But again, I think coupled with, I want to see, it sounds real good to say, well, yeah, they're afraid of the Muslims, they respect the Muslims, and they're not going to mess with the Muslims. Because if that were the case, it would be all over the world the same way, and all over the city and all over the country the same way. And sometimes that level of respect is not there. So we need to build it up again, because I think that there was a time when definitely most of the people in the inner cities respected the Muslims. And that's for a lot of reasons. They respected the Muslims. And the irony is that partly because of the Nation of Islam. Because these were no nonsense brothers. Many of the brothers came from the street. Many brothers were definitely not afraid of the criminal elements. They were once part of it. In fact, some of them are known to the old criminal elements. We had a brother out of Chicago named Salik, and he don't mind me saying it. He was like the number one drug dealer in Chicago. So he became a Muslim. When he became a Muslim, when he moved into the area and opened up a masjid, he let them know, you're not going to mess with the Muslims. They respected him, so they had that kind of respect. Likewise, in New York City, we had some brothers who used to be drug dealers, used to be in the criminal activity. One of the best examples is Malcolm X himself, who was transformed after having been in prison. He comes out now, and he becomes respected. And those who used to know Dirty Red, Malcolm, respected him. And part of the respect is the change that he made. And then part of the other respect is the strength that they showed. So I think, yes, the criminal elements, there is a level of kind of respect for the Muslims.
And when you were successful in cleaning up this area from the drug dealers and other undesirables, how did that affect the dawah effort? I mean, did it enhance the dawah efforts for the Muslims in this area?
We got so much publicity from this. Every major media came here, covered it. We were on the front page of Times, New York Times newspaper, Times Magazine, Newsweek Magazine, USA, and World Report. They came from France, Italy, German, all over the world, Turkey. They came and said, how did you do it? So we got a tremendous amount of publicity.
Let me tell you something interesting happened. When we were, and when we were having the drug patrols, it was so famous that a couple of things would happen. When we, our area, where we are on Bedford Avenue, Fulton Street, is a major thoroughfare. And we got buses coming from both ways.
And I'm sorry, not to interrupt you. I know it's a major thoroughfare because my grandfather used to bring watermelons from North Carolina, and this was his favorite spot to sell watermelons.
Okay, so what happens when the buses came by, it was really interesting. The people would literally come from the on the bus and look and point. So there it is. There they are. Right? And it was like, and some people told me that sometimes they would get off their stop a couple blocks before so that they can walk on our block. There was a woman, a Jehovah Witness, who told me, old lady, that she came to the masjid. Never been to a masjid before. She said, listen, I used to hate Muslims. I tell you the truth. I used to hate Muslims. But when I saw what you guys did, I just wanted to say thank you very much. Thank you for the community. Thank you for the neighbors. An old lady came once, a Christian. She came in and she sat down and she started just talking to me like she was my grandmother or something. And she stayed for hours just talking. She felt so comfortable. Never been into a masjid before. One of the... we have a lot of businesses in the area. When the 40-day patrol was over, one of the people from the businesses came and said, well, that was a great patrol. When are you going to start it again, and how much will it cost? So people were so ecstatic because, I mean, literally, the people in this neighborhood, it literally changed their life and their standard of living and their quality of life. So, I mean, we didn't have to go out and invite people to come in. They came in on their own. And not only did that affect the Muslims here, right here, in this particular area, but I was told by many imams across the country the same thing. Because now, because of the mass media, and they saw what the Muslims were doing, they were, like, ecstatic. And people talking about, wow, these Muslims are really wonderful. And then around the country, began the copycats. Many people began to do the same thing, have anti-drug patrols.
Alhamdulillah.